Alright. Change can be very difficult. Change is necessary. Change is necessary if we're going to make it into the kingdom of God. We have to change. We cannot remain as we are. Last week, the week before that, our speakers reminded us that tongues or speaking in tongues is not the evidence, initial or otherwise, of the possession of the Holy Spirit. It would be easy for us, you know, we would know that we still have the Holy Spirit and that we are walking with God and with God out of the word and we continue to do so. Others would know. However, we know better. It is not about speaking in tongues. But there is a question. How do we know that we have the Holy Spirit? How do you know that you have the Holy Spirit? I don't know if anyone has ever wondered if you really have the Holy Spirit. You don't see any miracles. You pray for a person. You pray for a situation. And it seems as though what my sister said about the Spirit being witness. The Spirit is not bearing witness. Because what you're praying for, believing you're praying in the Spirit, with all kinds of prayers, is not working out that way. Well, brothers and sisters, the Bible tells us, it answers the question, how do we know? How do others know if we have the Spirit of Christ? Romans 8 verse 9 says, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. Therefore, this is a very important question for us to answer. In Christ, in his own way, as he was wont to do, opened up the Word of God, and he answered this question, I believe. Turn with me in the book of Matthew. Let's go to chapter 7. In verse 50, he says, watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. It is by their fruit you will recognize them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by their fruit, you will recognize them. Brothers and sisters, change. I want to talk to us about change. Once upon a time, before God called us, before we came into contact with Jesus Christ, before we dip on the waters of baptism. Before hands were laid upon us and prayers were uttered to God on our behalf that we should receive the Holy Spirit, we live a different kind of life, a different way of life. We walk according to the pattern of the world, as Paul puts it. But having being united with the Spirit of God, something has to change. We cannot remain the same. Change is absolutely necessary. In Galatians 6, Paul writes, in verse 7, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that he shall reap. For if he soweth his flesh, from the flesh he's going to reap corruption. But if he soweth the Spirit, from the Spirit shall reap life everlasting. Sowing to the flesh versus sowing to the Spirit. And the fruit, brethren, the fruit that Jesus Christ speaks about, by the fruit we shall know it. Good fruit versus bad fruit. We have heard it time and time and time and times again. Galatians 5. We have heard it over and over. Verse 16, where it says, live by the Spirit. Chapter 5 of Galatians, verse 16. And you will not gratify the desires of sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit. And the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other. Change is high. So that you do not do what you want. However, if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. And the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. We know them. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, addictions, arguments, and the like, etc., etc., etc. I warned, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. For the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against these things there are no law. We know them, fruit of the Spirit. But yet, ask yourself a question, as is appropriate for us to do. Who am I changed? Who exactly have I? Personally, ask yourself a question. You don't have to answer to anyone but yourself and to God. Who have I changed? Who have I changed? Who have I changed? Have I truly changed my way of life since I've begun this walk? My purpose is absolutely simple. No complex. I want to motivate us. I want to motivate us to make some long overdue changes in our lives. I want to motivate us to invoke the power of the Holy Spirit that dwells within each of us, so that we will make changes that are necessary to make it into the kingdom of God. I want to see you there. And if I am going to see you there, I have to make it. I have to make it. And in order for me to make it, there's some changes say there are some changes that you are going to have to make. No. But as I said, change is not easy. It is not easy. I don't know if you have ever tried, but I'm sure. The change, something about yourself. Maybe from a child, you struggle with anger. Hey, I mean, you should look so pleasant and, you know, but yes, I mean, we all have the things that we need to change. We all have the things that we need to change. Long, deep-rooted habits that we have acquired over the years. They are put on, living according to the patterns of this world. That we have problems shedding since we have decided to change our way of life. It's not easy. There are several barriers to changing. Several barriers, several things that are stacked against you. For one, change is awkward. It is awkward. It is against our nature. Paul says, the things I want to do, I don't find myself doing those. The things I know I'm supposed to do, Sister Lady. It's awkward to do it. When someone does it wrong, and you know that the right thing to do is to forgive and to let go. Go to them and to speak to them. When you have done something wrong, and the right thing to do is to go and apologize, to put your pride aside, it's awkward, it feels uncomfortable. It's against our nature. Barriers to change. Change can bring you loneliness. Loneliness. You need to isolate it. When you're in the world, you have your clique, you have your friends, you created all these bonds. You know, people of like mind, like spirits, chemistry. And then you decide to turn around your way of life, leave those friends behind. And you come into the church, and guess what? The people are just not all that friendly. You come, hardly anyone talks to you. The person says, Hi. You might get a couple handshakes, and a few highs on the Sabbath, and that's it. You know, you may even be aware that friends are taking up on you more than your new Christian brothers and sisters. They want to know, you know, are you thinking of this Christian thing? They're taking up on you. But your brothers and sisters are kind of left you alone. You know, unless you take up on yourself to get involved. Sister Hertha gets involved. So, you know, she has played the game. But she has a pleasant and open personality. You don't have that kind of personality, you're reserved. It's going to be a little difficult, challenging. You may be isolated. Change is hard. Change is also hard because it's a trade-off. You have to give up something. You have to give up things that you like. Things that you enjoy. Things that were always a part of your life. You have to give those up. And it's hard. Change can be overwhelming. Even now, coming out of the days of unleavened bread and Passover, and that long standing sin, or way of life that you have that you decided that this year you're going to tackle it head on. A few days after, just overwhelms you. Feel like you're drowning. Like you can't breathe. It's too much change to handle. Too much change to manage. You think powerless to change. You have tried over and over and over again. And it seems like you just do not have what it takes to be a different person. It seems like this is just who you are, this is just how you are, brother. And you can't change. You feel powerless. You feel helpless. In the moment when you know you're supposed to walk away, you just can't. Don't be like how. Change is difficult because you look at others and they seem so good at this thing. When will I ever get to their level? They're so spiritual. They're always praying, they're always fasting. I swear they don't have no sin in their life. No unwholesome thoughts. No, they seem like everything is just so holy and spiritual. So spiritual, you know? Always so proper. Greetings. My brother, my sister. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Greetings in the name. How bad word does not come from their mouth? How bad thought does not come in their mind? And when you look at yourself and the things that you are thinking about and the things that you are struggling to overcome and the things that you are doing, you feel ashamed to come to church and face these other persons. It's hard to compare yourself to others. Change is hard because we fall down. When we try to change ourselves, invariably we have relapses. You want to give up fits of anger. You want to give up fornication. You want to give up smoking. You want to give up drinking. You want to give up cursing the drivers on the road. You're having a good week and then Saturday morning somebody puts you off. All hell breaks loose. This is my word. The day I'm coming to church, Satan decided to take me. Relapses. We fall back into what default states. We fall back into our old habits. Change is hard. Where to change? It is hard, but it is absolutely necessary. We're going to make it to the kingdom of God. We're going to have faith. How? In John chapter 3, Jesus said in verse 3, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus, feeling a bit puzzled, said to Jesus, but how must a man be born again when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? What does the young woman get? Jesus answered him and said, truly, truly, I say to you, repeat it, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit Brethren, we have to be born again. It means that we have to change. Naturally, we're inclined towards things of the flesh. But we have to hold that trend. We have to put on, we have to take on the mind, the spirit. And on another occasion, Jesus said in Matthew 18, verse 3, truly, I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Unless you change. Change is necessary. During these feast of weeks, leading up to the day of Pentecost, the first fruit harvest, it is a period that represents change in the life of a believer. Having entered that covenant during the Passover, having accepted the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and deciding to change our life, to walk in a new way, these days, these weeks, this counting of the days, counting of the weeks, represents our life thereafter. Count the days, we are commanded, or better yet, I better put it this way. Make the days count. Don't just count the days. We have to make the days count as we progress towards the first two times. Brethren, the power of the Holy Spirit is available to all of us. God has availed the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ said, I will give you another comfort. And when I'm gone, you need to watch me. I will not leave you alone, but I'll come and I'll make my dwelling with you. We all have the Holy Spirit. Well, the Holy Spirit is available to us. It is said that Jesus Christ had the Holy Spirit without measure. And we all see the things that he was able to do. That very spirit that was in Christ. Same Holy Spirit that is available to us. The power is there. But the question is, why aren't we utilizing to full effect the power of the Holy Spirit that is there, not only to see us for the day of salvation? We know. Ephesians 1, verse 14 tells us that the Holy Spirit is given to see us. It is not only given for the gifts that each of us have in order to do the work of God, but the Holy Spirit is given to help us to change. The Holy Spirit is given to help us to change. And it is available. So even though change is hard, change is possible through the power of the Holy Spirit. But how do we use this power of the Holy Spirit to change our lives? That is the meat of what I want to talk about today. How do we leverage the Holy Spirit to accomplish, to achieve, change, the change that is hard but necessary in our lives so that we may enter the kingdom of God? Now there are four levels of change. The first level is about knowledge. First level of change is knowledge. What do you know? Change. What do you know? Of course, we can be ignorant of certain things, and we're ignorant of a certain way of life. Then we would not be able to change and to walk that way of life. That's the first step. Knowledge. What do we know? The second level is the attitude. Change of attitude. Now, the gap between ignorance and knowledge is relatively small compared to the gap between knowledge and a change in attitude. We all know what is right. Read Galatians 5. We know that this is the template of what we ought to be, what we ought to demonstrate, how we ought to live through the Spirit. But yet, so often we find ourselves falling short of the second level, a change in attitude, change in how we think. And the third level of change is change in our behavior. What do you do? Having this knowledge, having this attitude, how do we carry out? How do we live? How do we change the things that we do? And finally, fourth level of change, not so much inward, but more outward. Influence. Your example. We're called to be disciples, not simply for ourselves, but the change that is taking place in us ought to spread to others. Change the influence by our example. Let's get down into how we can change our lives. Level by level. Level one, change your knowledge. This is by far the easiest, the most basic level of change. Change your knowledge. And I don't think many of us may have a knowledge gap. We don't have a knowledge gap. Hear the messages that have been here for a while. They start out long enough. You want to hear something. They're going to be exposed to some things, even outside of these halls. They have a Bible, they're going to read it. Open. And you're going to get some knowledge along the way. Even if you don't have the Spirit of God, even though we know that it requires the Spirit of God to truly understand the Scriptures, because it says that these words are Spirit. We need the Spirit of God to truly understand the Bible, to understand the Word of God. But even without that, you can read and you can get something. Clearly, God doesn't want you to do this. And God doesn't want you to give you. The Bible is clear of that. We need the Spirit to reveal that to you. Lines about it. We know that. Stealing is a bad thing. So persons don't know that perhaps that bad man is a bad thing. Covetousness. Dishonoring your parents. Bad thing. Bad thing. But we know, I don't need to spend a lot of time talking about changing our mind. Because we know what we're supposed to do. We know what we're supposed to do. But just to remind you, we have to keep, if we want to grow in knowledge and grace as the Scriptures encourage us, or as Peter tells us, add to your faith goodness, add to your goodness knowledge, we have to put on this increasing measure. We have to increase our level of knowledge. Therefore, we have to continue to feed on the Word of God. Matthew 4, verse 4, Jesus Christ said, when responding to the temptation of them, he said, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Read the Bible. How many of us read our Bibles every day? But probably we are taking part in God's. I really cannot read the Bible. See, but read the Bible every day. It's one of the basic things that we have to be doing as Christians. You know, if we don't eat food, we don't drink water, our body tells us that we are thirsty, it tells us that we are hungry. Does the Spirit tell you that you need to feed? You can have the great Word of God. Someone in prayer. You know, reading the word of God every day. That way you need food every day. You need to start with. That is one of the things you need to change. We're going to increase in knowledge. What helps me is the Bible app. Tremendous help. And they keep finding new innovative ways to keep me hooked into the word of God. There are so many plans. The plans have reminders. They pop up at a certain time to tell you, to remind you, hey, you need to read this, and it's there. Social media use those to good effect. They get us to keep checking back. They get a notification. Oh, someone comment on this. And you click it, and you select it. But when the Bible app pops up, know that you're supposed to read the plan today. Dismiss it, swipe it away. Read, and have this new thing. I like new version of Bible. Have this new thing called streets. Streets. You know, when you see, you know, people because I'm going to competitive. You know, I don't want to miss on the street. I want to go 300 days now. And, you know, I want to keep going. You know, you go on about 300 days and you drop off one day and then you start off at zero. So they're finding new ways. There are ways that we can build this habit of reading the scriptures, reading on the word of God. What are you going to do with the spirit working? In Hebrews 4 verse 12, it says, the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates, even to divide the soul and the spirit, joints and marrow. It judges thoughts and attitudes of the heart. You're going to be spiritual. You're going to grow in the spirit. You're going to empower the Holy Spirit to change your lives. You're going to feed the spirit. Feed the spirit. Read in the word of God. Pray. Fast it. You always know what you need to do. There are the start. There are basics that we need to be doing if we are going to really change. Growing up. Level 4. Change your attitude. Change your attitude. You have to change the way that we think. It is easy to change our knowledge. Read some new material, unlearn some material, unlearn some assumptions, and gain new knowledge. But it's to change the attitude. Change the way that we think. That's a challenge. We have developed a way of thinking over time. It's not overnight. We're not who we are just because of a happy history. We have made this up over years and years of training, years and years of repetition. I don't know if you have ever walked a path. I come from a country where you don't have paved roads. You know what you have is path. Tracks. Tracks. They have walking tracks. You know, it's bush on both sides. They just have a path where you skirt and you walk and that. And they have driving tracks. These are because of patterns. These tracks are because of patterns. Over time, people walk and trample and grass might no longer grow there. Even when rain falls, the grass, you know, they go where else. The tracks remain. So it is with our minds. Because of repeated action, repeated way of thinking, we tracks develop in our minds. And it's very difficult for us to erase those tracks and to create new tracks, which is exactly what is required of us. As we see in Romans 12, it says, do not conform to the pattern of the world any longer, but be transformed by the renewing. Your mind. So just imagine, your mind is this field with dirt tracks. You have several tracks in your mind that you have trodden along over the years. And now you need to go a different path. And that path has grass, and you need to dig up this one and grow some grass here and change completely. It's going to be hard. It's going to be hard. And Ephesians 2. Verse 3, 4 says, when we live among the Gentiles, when we live among the secular, in the world, we live according Therefore, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. These great trails in our mind. So, how can we change our attitude? How can we change our way of thinking? For one, we have to become a whole lot more aware. Aware. Self-awareness. Knowledge. We know the sort of thoughts we're supposed to be having. We know we're supposed to be something in the kind of thoughts we're not supposed to have. And the sort of action and so forth. We have to be able to capture our thoughts. But that's such a level of awareness. That when our mind is free, when our mind is going along, we can say, wait, I know that this part of my mind is going down. It's going down one of those old paths, those old world paths that I'm trying to change. You have to stop in the tracks, turn around, and walk in a different direction, think in a different direction. As 2 Corinthians 10 tells us, it says, bring every thought on adaptivity and make obedience to Christ. Starts in the mind. Starts in the mind. Starts in the mind. Capturing our thoughts. That's the habit that we have to develop. I know we are accustomed to sitting down and daydreaming. We have a seat and you're looking and but sometimes people just say, you want to understand what I hear when you're coming. Yes. They're lost in their thoughts. You can't get lost in their thoughts. You can't afford to get lost in their thoughts. Now, if you capture the thoughts and make them obedient to Christ, turn them around. Stop walking those tracks so that they can recover, so that they can change. The Holy Spirit can help us. It is the Holy Spirit which convicts us of sin. Don't you have ever been something comes suddenly upon you? You know, someone just offers you a number. Someone offers you a number. You know, it's work for you. Someone just comes and, you know, you can give me a call sometime. Something like that. You know, it's all innocent or, you know, you're working on a work project and you mean you discuss it outside of work hours. Or, you know, yes, you want to speak up somewhere that is outside of the day. Let's all speak up outside of work. Let's chat. Let's just, you know, it's always suit and tie and pop down and do. And you might, you know, you're kind of, you might say, personalize. It's it. It's just, there's a lot of there. I said, no, that's not where you're going. This is not where you're at. And just keep it here. And there's another path in mind saying, close it. Just leave it alone. You're not going to lose anything by saying, no, we can always talk here. But you know what you think. Or you call them. The car comes, you know, innocent, and it's all pleasant and good. And slowly, you know, slowly. It's why, you know, you keep getting that thought, you know, you should stop this now. It's not any further. I'm not going here. It's still in safe zone. By the time you realize that they're both at the same door and a slippery slope, you can't come back. But we have to listen to the Holy Spirit. Because it does come over mind to you. If we're honest with ourselves, when we're doing something bad, we get an inclination that, you know, I really need to stop this right here. I shouldn't go any further. I should not come this way. I should not take this call. Come to us. You know, I should answer this person. Come to us. Walk away. Walk away. But we feel like we can manage our, you know, we say we have to take our school now. So we continue going. And we miss those red lights, those amber lights that are there in our minds. That God has put, God has been warning us. We have to capture these thoughts. We have to obey the signs, the warning signs that the Holy Spirit gives us. Because it does. Just make haste. Don't take time. Don't have to run. You take your time. I said, no. Give me a loan, you know, I'm ready to go. Or give me back my phone. No, give me back my phone.
Spirit. That is what the Holy Spirit works. It's not so much about
mystery. It's a mind of God communicating with the mind, with your mind, that is bringing about the change. So you have to change your thoughts. You have to listen to the words of God. You have to listen to your conscience when the Holy Spirit pricks you and take the warning signs that God has set up. Give you, help you to change. To change your knowledge. Change your attitude and your way of thinking. Well, that's not enough. We have to change our behaviors. Things that we do. This is level 3. Change your behaviors. By behaviors, I'm going to focus on primarily our words. There are many other things, many other behaviors, patterns of behavior that we have. What does it tell you? You see, you can learn to make your tongue, your mouth, your words obedient to Christ. You are almost there. Don't believe me? James said it. James said this in James chapter 3, verse 2. He says, we all stumble in many ways. Stumble in action. Stumble in the mind, in the thoughts. What he says, but anyone is never at fault in what they say. He's a perfect man. Able to keep their whole body in check. So in other words, 80-20 rule, focus on the big rocks. You want to make a massive change in your life, learn to control it. Do this. Can you do this? We're almost there. You can control the tongue. Then keep your way far away to change your life and your behavior. And James also said, my dear brothers and sisters, in James chapter 1, verse 19, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen. Slow. If you slow down and not so quick to speak, you're going to be a better Christian. Right? Just like me, not one thing. You take one thing away from this message. Slow down. Don't be quick to speak. And you have to change those thought patterns. You're thinking about the girl, you're thinking about the man. Don't say anything to them. Don't say anything to them. You're thinking about giving somebody a piece of your mind. You're angry. Come on, do somebody something. Just far away. Far away. We can learn to ride the tongue. Be the covenant of Christian. He start the exhibit. Change. That's it. I learned this. Hard way. I wish. Every time again. Don't know what was going on that morning. But she said something. And my response was three words. Like what I mean, it's not I love you. Man, say those words. Give them to me. Better. Like I said, you chat too much. I tell you, that was the longest drive I've ever had. It was a long morning in the traffic. Long and very silent morning. And it didn't end here. I had the silent treatment for days.
You don't have the feeling, or you have the thought of the communication.
You can save yourself from so many problems. Just by putting the chop. Anger. Learn to hold. Now come on, something that is here. Because you still need to speak, you still need to come. Don't worry about it. I have no watch and watch the time and now some. Before you speak, think. Before you speak, before you act, think. Ask yourself, is it true? What you're about to say is true. Who? Is it helpful? Very well, it's true. Not yet. Is it inspiring? Everyone, when you speak, you should speak to encourage and inspire. Whenever we're going to speak, maybe what we're saying is true. Maybe it would be helpful for certain way that we say it. Is it inspired? And is it necessary? Not everything would be equal. Might be true, but is it necessary to say this at this point? And A, is it kind? Is it kind? Before you speak, think. True, is it helpful? Inspiring, is it necessary? Is it kind? Eight, four. Graduate, do this simple thing. Learn to slow down. And think before we speak, there are no ways. Positive, godly shape. Knowledge, attitude, behavior. Three levels of change. What about level four? Changing others. Change others through attitude. We master the first three levels of change. When we're on our way to becoming an influential person. We truly change all that. Persons can see that we are a changed person. Then you have opportunities to relay this gospel, to tell others about friends. If we are the same, are not much different from how we were when we were in the world, what are we going to tell others about friends? What are we going to tell others about becoming Christians? Yeah. You don't have any credibility. No authenticity. Change ourselves before we can see the change others. Christ said, take a plan out of your eye before you try to see take a speck out of your brother's eye. You want to help each other, change yourself. And then we can help in the change. Others. One thing I've learned, people are not impressed by what you know. You can be the most brilliant person, but if you're arrogant, you have a bad attitude, you talk down to people, they are not going to respect you. Or what you mean, but you're respecting, they're impressed. I hope you live. You are. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 30. Matthew 5, verse 30. You are the salt of the earth. But the salt loses its saltiness. How can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under. He says, you are the light of the world. Town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bulb. say they become a stand and give light to everyone in the house. The same way, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good deeds and glorify Father. Brethren, change should be from inside up. Once we have started to change our lives, change our knowledge, change our attitude, our way of thinking, change our behaviors, then it shines for us. First, say, what has happened? I've seen some sort of transformation in your life. How did you do it? What happened? The person becomes interested and opens the door for you to share the truth about Jesus Christ, the gospel that he did. Matthew 28, coming to a close. He gave a great commission. Verse 18 of Matthew 28. He says to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded. Surely, I am with you always to the very end of the age. For the disciples, followers, followership. We are not truly being disciples of Christ. We're not changing to become disciples of Christ. Then what are we doing in verse 3? Jesus said to the Pharisees, woe unto you, because you have taken these innocent children, these innocent people, and you have made them twice as bad. So it's much worse for us to be evangelized when we are such terrible people. And persons come and they think it's okay to be like this. Because we're not setting the right example. It's even worse. Better they leave the people alone than they bring them. And by your way of life, cause persons downfall. But we embrace the change. We become true disciples of Jesus Christ, then we are fit to carry out His commission. And we can teach people to obey everything that He has commanded us, not just by our words, our knowledge, but we can demonstrate to all lives, what a true disciple of Christ ought to be like. And then we can begin to change. Brethren, remember, we have been given the Holy Spirit to equip us to carry out the commission of God, which is to make other disciples. We have to use the Holy Spirit in ourselves, change ourselves, so that we can carry this commission and influence others at this fourth level of change. In conclusion, change. Change, brethren. We have to change. It's hard, but absolutely necessary for us to change if we are going to make it. Each of us, we have some things that we are working at, we need to work on, some things that we need to change. I cannot tell you what it is for you. I know what it is for me. There are still some things that I need to change. And the Holy Spirit that God has given to us, help us to change our lives. Change from living according to the patterns of the world, the ways which we followed before we were called. Change to us living according to the pattern of Jesus Christ. Remember the four levels of change. What are they? Knowledge. Change what you know. Feed the scriptures. Embrace them. Feed on the scriptures. Feed the Spirit with the scriptures. Each and every day. The Spirit needs the scriptures to do in order to change. What's the second level of change? Attitude. Change the way you think. Capture your thoughts. Make them obedient to Christ. And replace those sinful thoughts thing. Is it? Is it true? Is it helpful? Is it inspiring? Is it necessary? Is it kind? Think. Four. You speak. Slow down. Slow to speak. Quick to listen. And by just doing that one thing, just one aside, begin to move change in your life. Finally, influence. Four level of change. Influence. Change others. Let your light so shine before men that they may glorify. See your works and glorify Father in heaven. Brothers and sisters, may God bless you. May He empower you to change your lives, become more like the Son Jesus Christ, to the Holy Spirit, which has been each of us, to seal us, for us, faithful, day of God.